हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग ग्रेट। आई सीए पूजन कपाड़िया वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन माय टुडेज लेक्चर ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट मर्केंटाइल लॉ। फ्रेंड्स, इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी हैव सीन एंड डिस्कस अबाउट द सिलेबस दैट वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी इन द सेमेस्टर 5। अलोंग विद इट आई हैव टोल्ड यू हाउ द क्वेश्चंस विल बी आस्क्ड टू यू, अलोंग विद व्हिच वी हैव डिस्कस्ड सर्टेन इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक्स and we have tested your knowledge, first which I have made you learn what is law, in which you have studied law is different for different kind of people. Like for citizen, it was to obey the rules. For a lawyer, it was a profession or a vocation. For a legislator, it was a creation. While for a judge, it was a set of rules which he need to keep in mind at the time of giving judgment. Post which we had then the example of a traffic police who is catching a person who is driving a car without a license, in which we have learned a golden rule that ignorance of law is not an excuse. Post which we have learned the sources that the mercantile law which we are going to study, from where we have derived it. There were various sources like Indian laws, second was English laws, third was normal custom and usage, and fourth was judicial decisions. This is what we have covered in the last lecture. Today, I am going to start with your very first unit. I have named this act in the first lecture also. So we are going to deal with the first act, that is the Indian Contract Act, 1872. Yes, friends, learn it along with me. It is the Indian Contract Act. Year is 1872. If you come across any question from this chapter, you need to start your answer with the words, as per the Indian Contract Act 1872. I hope I am clear with the topics that we are going to cover today. Includes the first is, there are several definitions that we are going to deal with, certain terminologies which are technical. The word you might have heard, but the meaning as per law is the first thing we are going to deal with. Second is difference between agreement versus contract. And the last part, we are going to study essentials of a valid contract. So without wasting time, I am moving to the first slide for today. The first definition of the day, proposal or offer. I guess all of you might be aware about this word, that is proposal or offer. First of all, the first thing we need to understand at the time of studying any concept of mercantile law is the section in which the definition is given. Here, the definition is given in section 2, clause A. Yes, friends, you need to remember this. It is not actually mandatory, but it is definitely going to add on to your marks if you quote this section at the time of writing the answer. So we need to make a practice of learning the name of the act, that is the Indian Contract Act, the year of the act, that is 1872, and the section in which the topic is defined, that is section 2, subsection or clause A. The first definition is proposal. Now let's read what is written in the definition. When one person signifies to another. So from this first line, it is clear minimum we require two persons. One person signifies to another. Now what he is signifying? Let's see that in the first point. His willingness to do or to abstain from doing anything. See friends, there are two different parts in this particular line. First part is willingness to do. For example, I am going to start a startup for which I require finance. So what I'm doing is, I am approaching certain venture capitalists who can fund my project. So what I am doing is, I am showing my willingness to venture capitalist to invest in my project. This is something which can I relate with willingness to do. Against which there is a second thing, to abstain from doing anything. To abstain from doing anything, we can take another example. In the same example, if I am going to start a startup, which is something related to Ola or Uber kind of thing, that is car driving. So what I'm doing is, I'm going and requesting Ola cars to don't do business in my particular area. So what I'm doing over here is, I'm trying to stop them from doing the thing that they are doing. for which I'm proposing them. Please, you don't do business in this particular area because I want to start my own startup for this area. This is nothing. This is known as abstain from doing anything. So willingness to do or abstain from doing anything. In short, if I want to explain, I can say कुछ करने के लिए या कुछ ना करने के लिए. Fine, it is willingness to do or to abstain from doing. So let's read it again from the starting. When one person signifies to another his willingness to do or to abstain from doing anything with a view to obtaining the assent of that another to such act or abstinence. See, first of all, what I have done in the first part is I have shown my willingness in my first example to the venture capitalist that please come and invest in my startup. In the second example, I was requesting that don't do business in a particular area. So what I was doing is I was showing my willingness to do, and in the second example, to abstain from doing. Why I'm doing this? With a view to obtaining the assent of that person. In the first scenario, why I'm doing this? I want the confirmation, the assent, the consent from the venture capitalist that yes, they will invest in my company or my startup. In the second example, I have told them not to do business in my particular area. So I want that assent and consent that they won't be doing the business in my particular area. So there are three parts in this definition. First part is when one person signifies to another. What is signifying? His own willingness either to do something or to abstain from doing something. Why he is doing the same? Because he want to obtain an assent from that another person for such act or such abstinence. Then this thing is known as proposal. I hope I'm very clear with the definition. So let's read it totally once again. When one person signifies to another his willingness to do or to abstain from doing kuch karne ke liye ya kuch na karne ke liye with a view to obtaining the assent of that another to such act or abstinence. Why I'm doing so? Because I want assent, consent from that another person that either he'll do it or he will not do it. Then I'm supposed to make a proposal. The keywords of this definition that I have written in the below box are willingness, that is first of all the person should be showing his willingness, uski ichha honi chahiye that he wants to do or not to do something. Second is to do, that I have discussed that I want someone to do something. Against it I have written abstain, that is I want someone not to do something. And last is assent, that is I want assent, consent, confirmation from that another person. So what is proposal? Basically I am offering someone, showing my willingness that ha aap aur meri company mein invest karo, or I am showing my willingness that please aap ye area mein business mat karo. Fine, with a motive. Mera motive kya hai? That I want them to give their assent, so maan jaye ki wo mere company mein invest karenge. And in second example, wo maan jaye ki wo mere area mein business nahi karenge. Then this particular case is a part of proposal. It is defined in section 2 clause A. I hope I am clear with the definition. Moving ahead to the second definition. The definition is promise or acceptance. There are two words which are used interchangeably, promise or acceptance. This is defined in section 2 clause B. See, the sections are easy to remember. The first definition that we have studied is proposal or offer. It was defined in section 2 clause A. Second definition we are studying is promise or acceptance. It is defined in section 2 clause B. Let's read the definition. When the person to whom the proposal is made, if I want to decode this line in our example, then I was the person in the first scenario who was making proposal to whom? To the venture capitalist. In this particular case, I have made the proposal to the venture capitalist. The person to whom the proposal is made, that is venture capitalist, signifies his assent thereto. He is signifying his assent. He is giving me consent that okay, I will invest in your company. Or the second part says the proposal is said to be accepted. I hope I are getting my what I'm trying to say. The person to whom the proposal is made, what I was proposing the venture capitalist to come and invest in my company, he's signifying his assent. He's telling okay, I will invest in your company. Then this okay is said that my proposal is accepted. A proposal when accepted becomes a promise. This is the very important line you need to remember. There are two things over here. First, I had proposed the venture capitalist to come and invest in my company. What venture capitalist has done? He has agreed that yes, he is coming and investing in my company. So my proposal has been accepted. So when your proposal gets accepted, which is written over here, a proposal when accepted becomes a promise. The main keyword in this is signifies his assent. That is, he is giving his assent, his confirmation on doing or not doing something. So this is our second definition. You can see in the image I have kept over here, a person has proposed and the second one has accepted the proposal. So this is known as promise or acceptance, which is defined in section 2, subsection B. So let's recall both the definitions again. First was proposal, that what I was doing is I was showing my willingness that to do something or not to do something, or what was my motive? To get an assent, a confirmation from the person to whom I was making the proposal. The second definition was promise or acceptance. In this particular definition, what I was doing is the person to whom I have made the proposal, that is venture capitalist in our example, he is signifying his assent. He is giving confirmation that yes, he is going to invest in my company. This is nothing. This is the acceptance of my proposal. And a proposal, when accepted, becomes a promise. I hope I am very clear with both the definitions of proposal and promise. Section 2, clause A was the proposal, and section 2, clause B is the promise. Moving ahead to the very important definition, that is our third definition in this particular case. This defined is agreement. It is defined under section 2, clause E. Again, repeating, definition name is agreement, defined under section 2, clause E. Let's read the definition. What does it say? Every promise or every set of promises forming the consideration for each other is an agreement. Now, first, let's recall what is promise. We have read in the last line that when a proposal gets accepted, it is known as a promise. Now, what we have written over here is every promise or every set of promises. There can be any one promise or there can be a set of promises forming consideration for each other. In the introductory lecture, I have explained you guys that consideration is nothing. It is something in written. For example, I am doing my job. I am getting salary. So salary is nothing. It is the consideration for doing the job. So what we are talking about is there are two set of promises. A person was proposing that please come and invest in my company. That was promise that I was making from my end. What the venture capitalist done? He is saying, yes, I am coming and investing in your company. There is an interchange of promises in this particular case, which is forming consideration for each other. When this thing happens, it is known as an agreement. Fine. Now let's move ahead to the keywords that I have written over here. You need to learn the keywords. So let's focus on the important words. First point is there should be a promise or there should be a set of promises. Second is there should be a consideration. Consideration means there should be something in written. Third and the most important point, proposal plus acceptance is equal to agreement. One person was proposing, please come in my company and invest in it. The second person has accepted his proposal that yes, I'm coming in your company and investing in your company. The proposal plus acceptance makes an agreement. Now let's take an example. Rent agreement. For example, I am having a house property, a residential flat, which is empty. I am not using it. So what I have decided, I am going to let out the property on rent to any of the tenant. When the property is being let out on rent, I need to make an agreement that rent per month is going to be 10,000 rupees. Now what I am doing into is, I am entering an agreement. I am proposing the tenant that come and stay in my house. And what the tenant is telling, okay, I want a house on rent. The condition that I'm putting is you need to pay 10,000 rupees as a consideration. So what we are doing here is we are entering into an agreement. He is promising to me that he is giving to me, pay me 10,000 rupees. And I'm promising him that I'm going to give him my house to use for 1 month. But this is basically an agreement. This agreement can be legal because I can officially make a contract, an agreement. Fine. The agreement can be in a legal form. Let's take another example. What I've decided is I will take my family once in a month on a road trip. Fine. This my family was telling that we want to go on a road trip. I promised them. Okay, fine. I'll take you once in a month on a road trip. Now there are two set of thing over here. Family proposed that they want to go on a road trip. What I did, I accepted their proposal and told them, okay, we will go once in a month. Again, there is a proposal over here by family and there is an acceptance by me. So proposal plus acceptance is equal to agreement. Answer is yes. But the question arises, is this a legal agreement? Can you sue if I do not take my family on the road trip? Can my family come and make a case on me, file a suit on me? Answer is of course no. So this agreement is known as domestic agreement. So the main focus or your main attention I want to draw over is agreement can either be legal, that can be enforced by the law. If my tenant is not paying me 10,000 rupees, then can I file a suit, a case against him that he is not paying me or he is not fulfilling his promise? Of course I can, because it was a legal agreement. Against which, if I'm not taking my family on a road trip, can they sue on me? Can they file a case on me? Answer is no, because this is a domestic agreement. So main thing that we need to remember is agreement can be of different kinds. It may be legal, it may be domestic, it may be enforceable by law, it may not be enforceable by law. It is not necessary if you are entering into an agreement, it is always going to be legal. It may be legal, it may not be legal. Fine. Let's recall the definition, section 2, subsection E. Every promise or every set of promises forming the consideration for each other is an agreement. Fine. In which I need to remember, a proposal plus acceptance is equal to agreement. Agreement can be legal like rent agreement. Agreement may be domestic like a road trip with a family member. I hope I am clear with the three definitions. Quickly, I'm recalling all of them. First was proposal. I'll just recall the example so that you can easily relate it. First was, I wanted venture capitalists to come and invest in my company. I was showing my willingness that please come and invest. This is nothing. This is a proposal. Second was promise. Venture capitalists said, yes, I'm going to accept your proposal and I'm ready to invest in your company. This is the acceptance or a promise. Third is agreement. Then there are two set of promises. Rent wala example, in which I am promising to give my house for use and the tenant is promising to pay me rent of rupees 10,000. There is an exchange of promise. They are forming consideration for each other. This is known as an agreement. Section 2A, proposal. Section 2B, acceptance. And section 2E, agreement. Now let's move to the last definition. It is contract. As the name of the act says, the Indian Contract Act 1872. So it becomes inevitable for us to know what actually contract means. The definition of contract is given under section 2, clause H of this act. What is it? Let's see the diagram that is given over here in the format of equation. I have written three words. First is agreement plus enforceable by law is equal to contract. So I need to remember two things. I took an example of rent, fine, in which I told you if my tenant fails to pay the rent of rupees 10,000 per month, I can file a case against him. I can file a suit against him. In this particular case, we can say there was a rent agreement. Was it enforceable by law? Answer is yes. Then such agreement can be known as contract. In my second example of road trip with family, I made an agreement. Yes, I'm going to take you once in a month on a road trip. But if I'm not doing so, can they file a case on me? Answer was no. So it was not enforceable by law. As a result of which, it is not equal to contract. So we can say the line written over here, all agreements are not contract. That is, agreement, if it is legally enforceable, it can be contract. But if it is not legally enforceable, it cannot be contract. But at the same time, all contracts are agreement, because to being a contract, it is necessary to have an agreement. So now let's read the definition given in the act. An agreement enforceable by law is a contract. Any agreement, it may be related to purchasing a house. It may be related to giving a house on rent. It may be any damn thing you can think about. If it is enforceable by law, the meaning of enforceability is if someone do not satisfy the promise that they have made, you have a right, the another person have a right to file a case against him, to take the lawful legal actions against him. It is known as enforceable by law. So when an agreement becomes enforceable by law, it is known as contract. You may be asked, explain the statement like all agreements are not contracts, but all contracts are agreement. I guess now it is clear to you with the example of rent and domestic trip with the family. So till now, we have covered four important definitions of which you may face anyone as a short question in your VNSU exam paper. The four definitions were, first of all, we have done what is proposal under section 2 clause A. Second was promise or acceptance, section 2 clause B. Third was agreement, section 2 clause E. And fourth was contract, section 2 clause H. Moving ahead to the next topic, what is the difference between agreement and contract? You will say, sir, aapne example se samjha to diya, but let's study technically what is the basic difference between these two terms, agreement and contract. Let's start point wise. The first point is section and definition. Agreement is defined under section 2 clause E, while contract is defined under section 2 clause H. What was the definition for agreement? Every promise and every set of promise forming consideration for each other is known as agreement, while for contract is agreement enforceable by law is known as contract. Second point, enforceability by law. So whether it is legal for agreement, it may be, it may not be, but for contract, it is always enforceable by law. Third is legal object. That is, it is necessary to have legal object for an agreement. Answer is maybe. You may have a legal object, you may not have a legal object. Suppose I promises my friend to give him a treat at a dinner, but then due to certain reasons, I may not be able to give him the treat. So my object is not legal over here. But at the same time, if I'm entering into a contract, my object needs to be legal. So here I've written always. Yes, there should be a legal object. Next point is consideration. Consideration is it necessary to have something in written for agreement? It may be. Again, I'll take the same example. If I promise my friend to take him on a treat at dinner, I'm not expecting anything in written from him. Fine. There may be consideration. There may not be a consideration. But for contract, consideration is must. We have a wording in MLaw, no consideration, no contract. So it is important to have a consideration for a contract. Moving ahead, damages for breach. This point means if someone is breaking the promise, are you having an aggrieved party, the person who is suffering the loss because of such breaking of promise? Do you have any power, any right against that person in agreement? Answer is no, because your agreement may be legal, may not be legal. But contract, it is of course yes, because it is enforceable by law. Next is binding nature. Is it compulsory for a party to fulfill a promise? For example, again the same example, I have promised my friend that I will take him for a dinner as a treat. So is it binding on me? Is it compulsory for me to take him for a dinner? Answer is no, it is not compulsory. It is totally up to my willingness. If I will, I can. If I don't want to take him, I won't take him. But at the same time, if it is a contract, it becomes binding on me. It is compulsory. And the last part is formula that we have already discussed in the slide of definition. What is agreement? When a proposal gets acceptance, it is known as agreement. That was my venture capitalist for example. I want fund, so I proposed them. That was a proposal. They want to invest. They said, yes, we will. That was the acceptance. When a proposal meets acceptance, it becomes an agreement. At the same time, what is for contract? When an agreement is enforceable by law, when we can give it a legal touch, it is known as a contract. This is already the one which you have discussed at the time of definition. But if it is asked in your examination, like state the difference between agreement and contract, you are having the 7 to 8 points which you can write in your examination. I hope I am clear till here. That is four definitions and this difference. Let's move to the next topic. The topic is valid contract. We have already studied what is contract. When an agreement is enforceable by law, it is known as contract. There can be many contracts, but for a contract to be valid, to be correct, there are certain conditions that are supposed to be fulfilled. These all conditions are stated in section 10 of the Indian Contract Act 1872. Just to let you know, friends, all the sections that I'm going to discuss in this particular unit will be related to the Indian Contract Act 1872. In this, it is written section 10, all agreements are contract if there exist. We have studied all agreements may or may not be the contract, but all contracts are agreement. So if I want an agreement to be a contract, there are a list of points that I need to fulfill so that I can say, yes, my agreement is a contract. That is a valid contract. Let's take a quick look on the points that are written over here. The first point is there should be free consent. That is, you should not force another party. I cannot force venture capitalist that you need to come and compulsorily invest. For example, the venture capitalist is my student. Then I cannot take the undue advantage of my position of being a teacher. It is totally up to him. It is totally up to his choice. I am not making any kind of force. The first point is the promise or the acceptance of the promise should be by the free consent. It should not be backed by any kind of compulsion, any kind of fraud, etc. Second is parties competent to the contract, which means I am entering into a contract only with the parties who are competent, who are capable enough to enter into a contract. For example, the venture capitalist in my case was of unsound mind. He was mentally unstable. Then practically speaking, he is not a person, a right person who can enter into a contract. So he is not competent to the contract. So the second condition is the parties to the contract should be competent enough to enter into a contract. Third is lawful consideration. Lawful consideration is you should have something in written which should be legal. I cannot say that if I do certain work, I will kill your brother. Are you getting me? I cannot do any illegal things. The consideration that you are receiving should be totally lawful, should be totally legal. Fourth is lawful object. The purpose of the contract, the objective of a contract should also be legal. For example, alcohol is banned in Gujarat. So I cannot enter into a contract of selling alcohol in Gujarat. This will be illegal or unlawful objective. So the objective of my contract should always be lawful. Next point is, it should not be expressly declared as void. See, void is something which is not valid. Fine. So I cannot enter into something that is not valid. Now I will explain the exact meaning of void in the later coming slides, maybe in the next lecture. And the last point is it should fulfill legal formalities of any other law. If there are any other laws in India which require certain formalities to be fulfilled, they should be fulfilled while making in the contract. So in crux, if I have to say to make an agreement, a contract, or to make my contract valid, there are these 6 important points that should be fulfilled. First is there should be a free consent. That is, there should be no force. There should not be the dominance of position. There should be no fraud at the time of giving the confirmation. Second is parties who are entering into a contract should be competent enough. They should not be incapable to enter into a contract. Third is consideration. That is, something in written should always be lawful. Fourth is object. The purpose of the contract should be lawful. Example of alcohol, which I told you. Fifth is it should not be expressly declared as void. That is, a contract should be valid. It should not be upfrontly declared as that it is not valid. There are certain points under this point, which we are going to discuss in the later slides. And last is if any other law requires any legal formalities, it should be fulfilled by the contract. So to tell you guys, we have done till now 3 important sections. First was definition part. Again, to revive you with this definition of a proposal, that is willingness. I want someone to invest in my company, venture capitalist, section 2, subsection clause A. Second was promise, section 2, clause B. I have invited him, I have proposed him, he is accepting my proposal, then it becomes a promise. Third is agreement. Every promise and every set of promise forming consideration for each other. That is section 2, clause E. And the fourth was contract, section 2, clause H. That is agreement, which is enforceable by law, is contract. Agreement may be legal, right? Our rent, our example. And second, agreement may not be legal, like for example, our road trip. Fine. Moving ahead, difference between agreement and contract. And the last part is to say a contract to be valid or to prove an agreement can be a contract, I need to fulfill certain considerations, certain points that are written over here. I hope you are clear till what I have taught you up till then. Now, is it time to test your knowledge? What I am going to do is, I am going to show you 5 different MCQs. I will be providing you 25 to 30 seconds for each MCQ. In this time, you need to mark the correct answer with you. After completion of all the 5 MCQs, we are going to discuss the correct answers. I hope I am clear with the instructions. So your time starts now. Well, students, I guess you are ready with your answers. So it's the time to check the correct answers. The first question was, when an agreement is enforceable by law, it is known as, remember? Yes, right answer is option C, contract. An agreement which becomes enforceable by law is known as contract. So correct answer is option C. Question number two, a proposal when accepted becomes a, answer is promise. Fine. We have learned in section 2, clause B, when a proposal gets accepted, when a venture capitalist gives his assent to accept his investment, is known as promise. The correct answer is B, promise. Question number 3. A contract is not valid if it has, we have just studied section 10, there are certain conditions to be fulfilled. There should be a lawful purpose. Answer is yes. There should be a lawful consideration. Answer is yes. There should be a free consent. Answer is yes. There should no be force, no fraud, etc. There should be void. Answer is no. It should not be declared as void. Here what I have asked is, a contract is not valid if it has, the correct answer is, if it is void, if it is not valid, then the contract is not supposed to be valid. So the correct answer is B, is void. Fourth, every promise and every set of promise forming consideration for each other is called agreement. Correct answer is B, agreement. In this particular case, we have referred section 2 clause E is a definition which is given in the act. Fifth question, contract is defined under section. Time to test your brain, right? Correct answer is option D, section 2 clause H, because the first is 2A, it refers to the proposal or offer. Second is 2B, it refers to promise or acceptance. Third is 2E, which refers to agreement. And last is 2H, which refers to contract. So the correct answer of this question is option D, 2H. I hope you might have got all the answers correct. If not, I would just request you to go through to the part of the video so that you have a clear idea of the definitions that we have studied of proposal, promise, agreement, and contract. Difference between agreement and contract, we have learned that agreement not necessarily be enforceable by law. If we need to make it enforceable by law, if we want to make the contract valid, we need to refer to section 10 and all the points written over here. I would like to stop over here for the day. So I thank you all for your patient listening. Hope to see you soon in the next lecture. Thank you.